انتم تستمعون الى الديوانيه
نخيم معزينين لديوانيه
ديوانيه ديناميك بزنس
انتم مكشيفين لديوانيه
انتم تستمعون الى ديوانيه
from the Moshe Dayan Center at Tel Aviv University you're listening to ديوانيه. Hi, I'm Ben Silsby for Diwania. We're here today with Cenk Sagnich. He is a student at Ben-Gurion University and an instructor of the Kurdish language. So, Cenk, tell us about your family origins.
Thanks for the invitation. I was born in northern Kurdistan, which is Turkey on paper. And my family, they come from the region that's close to the Iranian-Turkish border. And I grew up in Ankara because my family was forced to leave Kurdistan in the 90s. They're known for traditional work for the Kurdish cause. And my grandfather was among the founders of the Kurdish Democratic Party of Turkey. And he was also a linguist who wrote numerous books about Kurdish.
Can you tell us a little bit about the KDP in Turkey?
KDP in Turkey was founded in the 60s, which was not officially connected to the KDP in Iraq or in Iran, but was sharing the same ideology and same symbols and whatever you call.
What was the ideology?
The ideology wasn't that sophisticated during that time. So, I mean, if you look at today, Kurds are coming up with too much sophisticated ideas and things and thoughts and, you know, philosophies. But back in those days, the objective was so simple because there was a dead man you had to awake. That was the Kurdish identity and the Kurdish people itself. So the main part they shared with the KDP Iraq was their loyalty to the movement initiated by Mullah Mustafa Barzani.
Some of our listeners, I think, are not familiar with the geographic area. Can you tell us where that is and what that consists of?
That is also difficult because Kurdistan's map was made by a political movement towards the end of the Ottoman Empire and beginning of the modern Turkey. And they used political methods to make a map. So they tried to see in two ends. One is in Turkey and the other one is in the Gulf, which is for many is not true. It doesn't represent the Kurdish population and the Kurdish historical area. So there's no consensus about where is Kurdistan. But we know that Kurds are living in the southeastern and eastern parts of Turkey, below the historical Armenia. Then it goes to Iran and in today's Western Azerbaijan and the Kurdistan province of Iran, alongside with Lorestan is another province in the south. It's considered to be part of historical Kurdistan. And then you go into Iraq, you have, again, very political aspirations in designing the maps. But what we know is today's KRG, Kurdistan's Regional Republic, represents the core Kurdish areas. Plus, we have the area which was supposed to be decided upon by the application of the Article 140 of the Iraqi Constitution. Is a disputed areas, including Kirkuk and Mosul and some parts of it. This can also be called Kurdistan. And then you go into Syria. I think you had a good interview with Kemal Sido.
With Kemal Sido, yeah.
Yeah, so it's exactly the northern, sharp northern part of Syria, which is very close to the sea, but Kurdistan never meets the sea, so.
And so we have these numerous different Kurdish national parties. Do they all have different ideas of what is Kurdistan? In Iraq, for example, you have the Kurdistan Regional Government. It's autonomous. Do some of these groups still have aspirations for a greater Kurdistan, or are they content to stay in the KRG in Iraq?
I mean, I remember a friend of my father was a director of a movie, and he said that every movie they start with the hope that they will get the Oscar. But towards the end of the movie, they all just want to just finish the movie and go on. It's the same thing for the Kurdish political parties. Everyone starts with the greater aspiration of the pan-Kurdist, greater Kurdistan, and even more sometimes. But once you're in core politics, you're dealing with a lot of things. Then it just gets shrink, wherever you can just save. So yes, if today, you know, for example, in Turkey, there's now a new political movement initiated by some former Kurdish politicians who are restarting their project. If you ask them, they're going to tell you about the greater Kurdistan and what are their ambitions. But if you go to a Kurdish political party in Iraqi Kurdistan, which had a lot in the past, they're not going to tell you about the greater Kurdistan. It's just not more than as an imagination, but they will be more realistic. So this is like two ends. One is too idealistic and the other one is too realistic. Problem is there's no one in between.
And so we've been talking about the Kurds as one people, but there are several different languages. Can you tell us a little bit more about the divides among the Kurdish population?
Kurds are one people, which is weird. It's just so unique because it doesn't fit into the picture of any kind of ethno-nationalism we see in the books. This might be because the field works are never done in Kurdistan when social sciences were writing about nationalism. This is weird because if you take Kurds as a part of the second and the third waves of nationalism, which is not nationalistic in its core and its origins, but nationalistic because it's reacting against its authority or the superior nationalism, then you should have had four different Kurdish nations because they were opposing four different authorities in Turkey, in Iran, in Syria and Iraq. But interestingly, at the end of the day, you have one Kurdish nationalism, which is impossible to be divided. I mean, you cannot separate or isolate the Kurdish coast of Iraqi Kurdistan from Turkey because the founder of Iraqi Kurdish nationalism was in prison in his mother's body in Diyarbakir when she was pregnant. And at the same time, you cannot isolate the same guy, namely Molosa Barzani, from Iran because he was the general commander of the Kurdistan Republic's army in 1946 in Iran. This is what makes Kurdistan weird. And the language issue, there's no consensus to call them dialects as languages. Also, it's possible to call them languages because they're too different.
Are they mutually intelligible?
Somehow. I always said that if you find two illiterate Kurds never been to school, in the schools of the authoritarian states of Iraq or Turkey or whatever, they will understand each other because this is Kurdish, you know? But still, I don't think it made any effect on Kurdish national identity and stuff.
So it's not a political issue in Iraq, for example?
Never been a political
issue.
Which
Kurdish language is
spoken? No, it's never been a political issue. I remember in 2003-04, when I first went to Iraqi Kurdistan, I remember the Kurds living in the northern parts of Kurdistan. I mean, Kurdistan, Iraqi Kurdistan, means Zakhodhog and the other regions, which were where they speak Kurmanji. They used to communicate with Kurds from Sorani-speaking regions in Arabic. So that was their medium language. But this was an effect of the Arabization policy and the provision of Kurdish from any kind of from the market, from practical life. But eventually, rapidly after 2003-04, when Kurdistan was relatively independent or semi-autonomous and stuff. If you go today, 2012, you will see one side is using his own dialect and the other side is answering in his own dialect and they understand each other.
That's very different from, for example, here or North Africa, where the choice of language that you make is a very political issue. Do you speak French or do you speak Arabic? Do you speak Hebrew or do you speak
Arabic? The same in Kurdistan as well. If you don't calculate northern Kurdistan, that's three parts of Kurdistan, it's called shame, in quotation marks, to speak Arabic or English or Persian or whatever.
Among your own people?
Yeah. But still, because Sorani and Kurmanji were falling apart during the entire Iraqi history. And Sorani was a language for education in Baghdad and in Sulaymaniyah sometimes and in Iranian Kurdistan, but Kurmanji was never being. So this was the reason why Kurds from Kurmanji-speaking areas couldn't understand the ones from the south, and they used Arabic or any other medium language they could have used. But today, you see, once Kurds are a political entity, and once they are given the chance to rule themselves, yeah, they understand each other. And if you have a deep look in Kurdistan, you will recognize this, that one side is speaking Kurmanji and the other side is speaking Sorani, and they're chatting. And it's normal today.
How did you come to Israel? You're a Kurdish instructor in Israel.
Yeah.
What's that like?
I did my BA in a university where the language was English and everything was Western and stuff, because it was the first Western-style university established in Kurdistan. We have 3-4 now, but... And I had courses in Middle East and studies and stuff. So I just realized that, hey, I saw one part of this, and let's see the other part of Middle East. That was first reason. Second reason, I was aware that I was witnessing an establishment of a state in Iraqi Kurdistan. And I was aware that I was witnessing foundation of an official nationalism, of everything he can talk about a state was there. And this was resembling Israel's history as well in some ways. So this made Israel important for me too. Third of all, Israel is important for me. It's important for me because as long as Israel lives in the Middle East, that gives me hopes that we can also live. That also made Israel important for me to see and be here. So you can just call it was all emotional and political to come here.
Do you think that's a feeling that a lot of Kurds share?
No.
No?
No. I mean, you know, this is to the best of my experience. From any parts of Kurdistan, if you're talking to an intelligent person or if you're talking to an intellectual Kurd, they wouldn't be opposing Israel. And if you go deep and create trust, then they would have told you how these two histories and these two peoples are resembling each other and how close they are in regards to their histories and what they need to their experiences. But it is hard to support Israel. I mean, it is really hard. I mean, that's not something that someone would pick up to do the easiest thing. So I think we rather not to expect the Kurds to do this. And Kurds are not isolated from the media bombardment upon the people that goes all around the world about Israel. So they are also victims of these policies that, you know, I live in Beersheba, 400 missiles hits Beersheba, it's never on the media, and once the IDF, you know, reacts, it's just all everywhere. So we cannot isolate the Kurds from this media bombardment as well. So this is not the mainstream Kurdish ideology shares.
Speaking of Israel and Kurds, there are also, as I understand from an article one of our colleagues wrote, there are a lot of Kurds in Israel.
Yeah.
There are Jewish Kurds.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about that? What is their...
I'm not sure if you can call them Kurds.
Mm.
They're Jews. I mean, no regards to their religion, but they're Jews. They're Kurdish originated or from Kurdistan.
Tell me a little bit more about this. So you see them as Jews more than Kurds. They're from
I see
Kurdish
anyone
Kurds.
Who made Aliyah as a Jew, apart from his or her original identity or whatever, where she comes from.
Are there any practicing Jews left in Kurdistan?
Very few. In Iraqi Kurdistan? Very few.
Iraqi Kurdistan, really?
Yeah. Very few. I met someone here in Tel Aviv, and he said that he was suspicious about his own religion when he was in Iraqi Kurdistan with his family, because they were not practicing anything Islamic. They were not fasting, but not telling anyone outside. They were not praying, and his father wasn't a prayer. He never prayed. But they also kept talking about God and stuff and stuff, yeah. And stuff. And when he turned 17, his father calls him, says, "Okay, let's go, son, I'm going to tell you something. We're Jewish." So how can you call this family Kurdish? I mean, you're not free. No one would say that. Nobody surrounded that house, and you know, inspected if they were praying or not or what or whatever. But this is the common pressure upon all the Jews. So.
Would you say that Islamic identity is a very strong point for Kurdish nationalist parties?
That's impossible to apply in Kurdistan. I mean, if you look at Kurdish history, there's no Islamic political movement.
Yeah, it really doesn't seem like it.
Yeah, because it's impossible. Islam is a political movement itself, and it's a political, you know, behavior itself. So if you're initiating an Islamic movement, that means that you're a member of a greater club. But this is the same club that you're opposing. That's why it's impossible. And Kurdish Islamic tendencies or movements were always created after one nationalistic or whatever aspiration got something in one part of Kurdistan. I mean, in 91, the Kurdish nationalist parties in Iraqi Kurdistan, they got this, what they called the revolution, and they got a semi-autonomous state de facto. And then in 96, you had all these Islamic parties emerging, you know, same in Turkey when the PKK was really strong in the 90s, and they even pushed some parts of Turkish army outside Kurdistan in some cities for some days. Then you have the Hezbollah, the Kurdish political party, emerging. the Islamist one. So Islam cannot be a part of Kurdish identity as itself, but in a modified version, which is what we have in Kurdistan today. You know, they pray in Arabic, they fast, and they go to the mosque or whatever, but they feel that they're not accepted, they're not welcome.
So
in this club,
it's part of a religious identity. We also, when we spoke to Dr. Kamal Salido, he mentioned a lot the problem of he referred to them as assimilationist Kurds. They were Kurds that had been Arabized, is what he said.
Yeah.
In Syria, do you see that phenomenon in Turkey? Or
It is a very, very common topic in when you study Turkish studies and stuff. Turkification, and this succeeded in many parts of Kurdistan.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
You're welcome. Thanks a lot. I enjoyed it.
Thank you for listening to Diwaniya, conversations on Middle East culture, history, and politics. Diwaniya is produced by Shoshi Shmulevitz and Ben Silsby. For more information on the topic of today's show and our guests, please visit diwaniya.blogspot.com. diwaniya.blogspot.com.